can see a star shine, and its splendor fills up the sky. It's the same that appeared and the wise men revealed when hope was born this night. Out upon the snowy fields, there's a silent peace that heals, and it echoes the grace of our Savior's embrace, because hope was born this night. Glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, goodwill toward men. Let all of the world sing a chorus of joy, because hope was born this night. I can hear the Christmas bells ring as softly a church choir sings. It's the song used to praise the Ancient of Days when hope was born this night. There are angels in this place, and my heart resounds with the praise. Like a shepherd so scared, I'll rejoice and declare that hope was born this night. Glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, goodwill toward men. Let all of the world sing a chorus of joy, because hope was born this night.
Good to see you again. Welcome to our online celebration from Milwaukee United Methodist Church. This is the fourth Sunday of Advent, and we've had a wonderful season of anticipation of the birth of our Savior Christ. Hope, preparation, joy. This Sunday is about love. I can't forget peace, but that's all part of the mix of Advent here. So thank you especially for the last week off. Simpson College provided us a wonderful celebration of Festival of Lessons and Carols, and we're glad to take advantage of that. And thank you, too, for the birthday wishes, Pastor Jamie, and all of you who reached out to me and to congratulate me, too. So I do appreciate that. You know, he told me I had the Sunday off. I didn't realize that meant I had to work Christmas, so I guess there's always trade-offs, but what a great time of the year just to be able to celebrate all things. Especially birthdays. I think people that have birthdays around Christmas know what I mean, but we're still thankful for our birthdays. Let's just go ahead and center our thoughts on this time as we have a short prayer together. Dear Lord, wherever we might be and whatever we might be doing, I just thank you for the time we have together. I hope that people listening to this right now will just pause and reflect and just to set aside all the things that might be distracting them so that they can listen for your voice speaking to them, calling them to the manger. In your precious name we pray, amen. Well, again, thank you so much for worshiping with us today as we celebrate the love of Christ in our lives. Just some business we need to take care of here really quickly. We are still, Pastor Jamie, you know, don't listen. Kayla, don't listen. We are still collecting gifts for the staff. This is your last minute. You know, you can put a Christmas rush on if you hop on Realm and do an online gift for our staff. We would love just to show them the love of all of our congregation and support of the efforts that they do to support our ministries here in our church. So if you would do that, hop on Realm and make a gift that market to the category for staff gift, or you can send a check to the church office. Might not get here as fast, but we would love just to shower them with blessings this season. So thank you so much for contributing to that if you are called to. Okay, we got Pastor Jamie back and Michaela too. Good. I think we're in business. So now 4 or 5 weeks ago, I did lay down a challenge that I encouraged everyone to try and watch the services when they live streamed on Sunday mornings at 8:30. Or if you didn't have the opportunity to get up and do that, connect with other church families or people that you know would watch the service and watch it with them, just to kind of make a connection to make that time of worship something that's real and not just something you're viewing or consuming on the television. You have a chance to up on that challenge here coming Christmas Eve. So we have two services that will be streaming on YouTube like usual, but that'll be at 5:30 and 10:30. But we will also have the special opportunity to have live streaming on Facebook communion. So we'll have a special Christmas communion at 6:15 and 11:15. And if things are timed right, the online services should finish about the time that communion would happen. So just be prepared that communication will be coming in the Waukee Wire, and they'll be posted on our Facebook page to help you understand how it will all work. But we will have our traditional services at 5:30 and 10:30 with live communion following those. And, you know, unfortunately, we can't do traditions the way that we always have. And churches across the globe have so many special traditions that come to Christmas Eve services. So whatever you choose to do, I hope that you take a moment to pause and reflect and ponder on what it was like when Christ was born all those years ago. We do have special kits that are available, though, to support that service with the elements and other things to help you with Christmas. So those are being distributed over this weekend coming up. And so if you haven't received one Tuesday and are really wanting to have one for that service, please reach out to the church office and we'll make every effort we can to get one to you. Just know that we can only do that for people locally here. So sorry, Mom, we can't get one to Indiana that fast. But I hope that you will let us know if you don't get one and would like one of those to be able to participate in the service. So with that, we have a celebration to get on with right now for our fourth Sunday Advent. So I'd like to call for the Blakemans to help with the lighting of our Advent wreath.
Out of love, God spoke to his people through the voice of his prophet Isaiah. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a young woman shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. Last Sunday, we lit the candle of hope, remembering the hope which comes in Christ, the candle of peace, remembering God's dream of a peaceful world, and the candle of joy, remembering the Spirit within us who brings joy. Today, we light the fourth candle of Advent, the candle of love. God sent his Son so that we may no longer fear, but love. Scripture tells us there is no fear in love, for perfect love casts out fear. God created this world in love, and this world will end in the love of God. God's love pervades all aspects of this life. God's love has always been and will always be there. We light this candle in love.
Well, thank you so much for making our Christmas that much special for the lighting of our Advent wreath. Karla, I'd love to hear a children's message today. You have the stream.
Good morning, boys and girls. This is the Sunday before Christmas, so I want to talk about the lights of Christmas this year. You know, there are so many lights that we see around Christmas time, but I also want to spend some time talking about how those lights have color. And so really what I'm going to talk about are the colors of Christmas. I'm going to start with green. Green is all about everlasting. You see a green Christmas tree, and if it wasn't cut down and in your house, a green Christmas tree is the pine tree. It's everlasting. That is just like what God's love for us is. It's everlasting. It never changes. Just like that Christmas tree that's outside, that's growing in your yard. Then I want to talk about red. Red, to me, is kind of a sad color for Christmas, but I also know what it symbolizes or what it means. Jesus died for us. He shed blood for us. So the red reminds us, yes, remember Christmas, but also remember that Jesus died for us. And so that red symbolizes God's love, that he sent his son, and his son was crucified for us. Now I want to talk about white. White is by far one of my favorite colors for Christmas. I love white lights. And when I think of white, I think of purity. I think of perfect. I think of the shining light. And so white to me, when I think about Christmas, is the pure love that God gives us. And that if we ask for forgiveness, we are pure in his eyes. So boys and girls, white stands for purity, or what we would call clean. We're free from sin. Now, a color we don't see is black. To me, black symbolizes sin. Even though I am dressed in black, it symbolizes the sin that we commit every day. And even simple things we do when we disobey our parents, or we talk back to a teacher, or we lie, or we cheat. And we all do. We all have sinned. But I don't see black lights, do you? I hope I never do see black lights at Christmas time. Now I want you just to look real quick if you can. Next to me is our candles for Advent. And you will see a lot of decorations in silver, purple, and blue. I want to talk about two more colors. To me, when I see purple, I see royalty. It stands for people being important. And boys and girls, our Jesus Christ is important. He is our King. So we decorate with purple. Finally, the last color I want to talk about is blue. Blue, I didn't think was a very good color for Christmas. And then I read something where it stands for water. Blue stands for our baptism. When you were a baby, your mom and dad might have had you baptized. It reminds us to remember our baptism, when God took us in his arms and is with us and with the church. Remember your baptism. Boys and girls, this Christmas, I hope you look at your tree and look at the lights and think about some things that I've said. And those are truly our symbols of Christmas in the colors that we decorate with. Boys and girls, let's pray. Dear Father, thank you for these boys and girls as we learn more about you and the colors of Christmas and how important each color is. And when we decorate, it's not about Santa all the time, and it's not about the presents. It's about you and your son that you gave us. Amen. Merry Christmas, boys and girls.
Thank you so much, Karla, as always. And Christmas is such a beautiful time of the year with all the different colors, if the white snow isn't covering everything else up. But it's great to know all the meaning behind those colors. It helps make it real for us. Well, it's time to share a carol. We have a carol with Jen and Kara.
Stars in the sky.
thank you so much again for sharing the carols with us and the beautiful music you shared with us throughout the year. If anything, you know, some of my favorite songs in the hymnal come from this time of the year, so it's glad to be able to share them even virtually. We're coming to a time of our celebration for a prayer time, and many people know that I just pray off the cuff. I'm very much in the moment with what I'm thinking about, and sometimes that's kind of hard to pull away from and just share with you a meaningful prayer or a prayer that that is, you know, scripted. But I do want to kind of bring us together at this time. Just, you know, we've been, I don't know for you, but Christmas has been crazy for all of us. And even though we've been isolating and we've been quarantining and we've been trying to avoid people, people are still such an important part of all the traditions and activities that go on at Christmas time. So if anything, I guess I want you just to take a moment and think about the anticipation of Christmas. What really are you anticipating? What have you been preparing for? What do you look forward to the most this coming week? Let's go ahead and pause and take our thoughts to the Lord in prayer at this time. Dear Lord, our Heavenly Father, I'm just taking a moment to let my hair down, take a deep breath, and just to pray. Lord, everyone here praying with me right now, I'm sure is swept up in all sorts of confusion and excitement that comes with the anticipation of Christmas. What does that anticipation mean? It's something different for each and every one of us. Lord, many of us are in different places in our Christian journeys, and many of us are in different places with the things that are impacting our lives at this time. Lord, I know I hear stories every day of people that have had close calls with illness or have had family members that have had to go to the hospital for emergencies or have had unexpected illness or bad news at work, or even worse, they have an empty seat at their table or a place around their Christmas tree that will no longer have someone there that used to be a meaningful and important part of their lives. And Lord, you know, thankfully there are some of us that have been relatively unaffected, and we can be shining as lampposts for those that are in troubled times. We can take the ways that you've blessed us, and we can pass those blessings on to others. For really, that's the true meaning of Christmas. God with us, you with us, the love of Christ. But Lord, should we really be children of Christmas, or are we really children of Easter? Or as we approach Christmas and the hope and the joy and the peace, the love that comes with that, we're just starting on a journey. The journey of your son's life on this world. The journey that leads to one place. That place where Christ makes his sacrifice, his atonement for all of our sins, for all of eternity. So Lord, as we come to the manger, I hope that each and every person comes with the attitude of repentance and acceptance of that gift. For Lord, there truly is no greater gift that anyone could give than your love through a beautiful baby boy. So let us share the Lord's Prayer together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, I do hope that everybody feels the love of Christ at this particular time of the year. And, you know, this sweater keeps bothering me because it's an old, worn-out sweater that's so loose and dangly, but it actually is really warm. And maybe that's a great sign right too there, that when you think of the love of Christ, you can think of a nice, warm sweater keeping you warm during these cold days. Anyway, we have a scripture reading for you this morning. Dennis, will you share with us, please?
Thank you, Dennis. Our gospel reading today comes from the Gospel of St. Luke, chapter 1, verses 26 through 38, the story of the angel Gabriel visiting upon Mary. And in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou art highly favored, the Lord is with thee, blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest. And Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. And shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom there shall be no end. Then said Mary unto the angel, How shall this be, seeing I know not a man? And the angel answered her and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, she hath also conceived a son in her old age. And this was the sixth month with her, who was called barren. For with God nothing shall be impossible. And Mary said, Behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word. And the angel departed from her. Well, thanks be our reading of the gospel today. Back to you, Dennis.
Thank you so much for sharing the scripture today, a prelude to the great Christmas story that's about to unfold before us. Well, Pastor Jamie, we've had some music, we've had some prayer, we've had some celebration here. Why don't you help us bring this all together in a great Christmas message?
Well, thank you, Dennis, for your wonderful worship leadership and for bringing us the gospel for this fourth Sunday in Advent. I want to share with you the gospel reading directly before the gospel that Dennis brought us about Mary. It's found also in the first chapter of Luke, beginning in the fifth verse. I read this to you because these two gospel lessons are kind of parallel with one major exception that we're going to talk about here in the message. So, in the days of King Herod of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah who belonged to the priestly order of Abijah. His wife was a descendant of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. Both of them were righteous before God, living blamelessly according to all the commandments and regulations of the Lord. But they had no children, because Elizabeth was barren, and both were getting on in years. Once when he was serving as priest before God and his section was on duty, he was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to enter the sanctuary of the Lord and offer incense. Now at that time of the incense offering, the whole assembly of the people was praying outside. Then there appeared to him an angel of the Lord, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was terrified, and fear overwhelmed him. But the angel said to him, Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear a son, and you will name him John. You will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He must never drink wine or strong drink. Even before his birth, he will be filled with the Holy Spirit. He will turn many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God. With the spirit and the power of Elijah, he will go before him to turn the hearts of parents to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, and to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Zechariah said to the angel, How will I know this is so? For I am an old man, and my wife is getting on in years. The angel replied, I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and to bring you this good news. But now, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their time, you will become mute, unable to speak, until the day these things occur. Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondered at his delay in the sanctuary. When he didn't come out, he couldn't speak to them, and they realized that he had seen a vision in the sanctuary. He kept motioning to them and remained unable to speak. When his time of service was ended, he went to his home. After those days, his wife Elizabeth conceived, and for 5 months she remained in seclusion. She said, "This is what the Lord has done for me, when he looked favorably on me and took away the disgrace I have endured among my people." Listening to new music is hard. That's what Jeremy Larson writes in an interesting article I read recently in the music review website, pitchfork.com. And I think it has a lot of bearing on the gospel lessons for today. Larson says, listening to new music is hard. Hard compared to listening to music that we already know. Especially those who have settled into the groove of adult life often don't listen to new music because it's easy to forego the act of discovery when work and mortgage and children and life come into play. Eventually, the time comes when music is something to remember fondly rather than something to experience anew. Most people, he says, have all the songs they need by the time they turn 30. And then he goes on, the interesting part of the article, he goes on to offer the physiological explanation for our desire to seek comfort in the familiar and abhor the new. It can help us understand why listening to new music is so hard and why it can make us feel doubtful, skeptical, uneasy, angry, even riotous. It has to do with the plasticity of our brains. Our brains actually change as they recognize new patterns in the world. When it comes to hearing music, a network of nerves in our auditory cortex called the corticofugal network helps catalog the different patterns of music. When a specific sound maps onto a pattern, our brains release a corresponding amount of dopamine. That's the main chemical source of some of our most intense emotions. This is why music triggers such powerful emotional reactions in us when we listen to it. I mean, think of your favorite Advent hymn or Christmas carol here. The melodies and choruses of most of these songs have very recognizable chord progressions. And the majority of our brains have memorized these progressions and know exactly what to expect when each one comes around. So when the corticofugal network registers that music, our brains release the pleasurable and just right amount of dopamine. Like a needle tracing the grooves of a record, our brains trace these patterns. The more records we own, the more patterns we can recall to send out that perfect dopamine hit of Christmas cheer. But when we hear something that hasn't already been mapped onto our brain, the corticofugal network goes a bit haywire, and our brains release too much dopamine as a response. When there's no map or pattern to anchor to, new music can register as bad. And I'm not telling you anything you don't know. Every generation of parents with children knows this. Every parent has yelled to their kids, "Man, turn that noise down. What is that? I mean, ouch, it hurts my ears." That's exactly what happened one night in Paris back in 1913. In what is perhaps the most infamous musical debut in history, it was at the premiere of Russian composer Igor Stravinsky's The Rite of Spring. Stravinsky introduced some really new music on the fine arts community that evening, and as recounted in the daily paper, Le Figaro, early chuckles turned into jeers, then shouting, and the audience was whipped into such a frenzy finally that their cries drowned out the orchestra. Many members of the audience could not fathom this new music. Their brains, Larson writes, figuratively, but to a certain extent literally, he says, broke. A brawl ensued, vegetables were thrown, and 40 people were ejected from the theater. something like that happened to John the Baptist's father, Zechariah the priest. The news of God's grace and blessing to him was unfathomable to Zechariah, even from an angel telling him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayers have been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear a son, and you will name him John. You will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord." Because Zechariah and Elizabeth were elderly, and Elizabeth had never been able to have children, Zechariah's brain simply could not recognize the new music he was listening to. He had no personal experience in his marriage with the miracle of God's power to give life, to bless, to deliver from what the rabbis cruelly and wrongly called a disgrace. No pattern had been recorded or mapped onto his corticofugal network. Like the audience in Paris, his brain, along with his faith, broke. Because Zechariah wasn't willing to, in faith, receive the angelic news as good, because he wasn't ready to believe in faith that nothing will be impossible with God, he was then unable to share the good news with others. In Luke's gospel, we find another person who was also confronted with a new song of God's love for them. As Dennis read, God again sent the angel Gabriel, this time to a young engaged woman in Nazareth named Mary. "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." Now, this angelic greeting to Mary is found elsewhere in the Bible, most notably in 1 Samuel with Hannah and the birth of her son, the prophet Samuel, and also then in the book of Judges, in the assurances of power and favor given to the judges of Israel by God. Now, the common denominator in all of these greetings is that God very much desires and intends to bless and to use these persons for God's holy purposes. Hannah gives birth to a powerful prophet. Gideon crushes Israel's oppressive enemies. And Mary is to be the mother of God's own son who will one day become the Savior of the world. For as the angel proclaims, nothing will be impossible with God. But even with the angel's wonderful promise of God's favor upon her, Mary is still at first hesitant about saying yes to God. This new music hasn't yet mapped or grooved onto her mind and spirit to release any spiritual dopamine to allow her to rejoice. And can you blame her? Think about this. How believable do you suppose it would have seemed for an unwed teenage girl to say that she had become pregnant by God's Spirit? If she couldn't sell that idea to Joseph and others in the community, Jewish law directed that she could be executed for becoming pregnant by someone other than Joseph, or at least punished in a very severe way. But to her great credit and our eternal blessing, Mary decides to give this unheard-of news, this new song, a second listen. She says, "Yes, here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Grace Adolphson Brahme, writing in her book, Faith, the Yes of the Heart, comments on Martin Luther's quote, which is, "Faith is the yes of the heart, a confidence on which we stake our life." Brahme writes that Luther was saying, faith is a response of our whole self to God. This yes is an inner agreement of our will with God's will for us. It is a willingness to receive the love and the guidance of God into our lives and into our daily living. It's like listening to a new song over and over and over until it stops being foreign and starts mapping its now recognizable and beautiful patterns onto our brains. The grooves it cuts can be so deep and far-reaching as to cause a real conversion of our lives, a real repentance, a turning around of ourselves to go in a completely new direction, God's direction. It always involves, says Luther, our daily death of the person that we have been in order to fulfill our reason for being alive. And that is, he says, to accomplish God's will in our time and place where God has put us. For many of us, that daily death just may include dying to the routine, comfortable, insulated, away from the rest of the world practice of saying no to God and others. It may have to include changing some of our plans for the new year and the post-COVID era. As Maria Bolding writes in her book, The Coming of God, you have to jettison your small plans, because the Father's plans for you are unthinkably greater and more wonderful. You have to leap into God's hands, say an unconditional yes, and be born anew. God's love exceeds everything that you deserve or even desire. So remember the words of the angelic voice, for nothing will be impossible with God. My friends, let's all receive that promise for ourselves today. Now, let's be clear though. Mary's obedient, self-giving, her making herself totally available to God's will and purpose for her life, that is the example for all of us, for every person, for you and me, for everyone's life who has been blessed by God. Mary was favored and would give birth to the King of Kings, but only if she gave herself obediently in response to God's call. That's the unchangeable truth. Our greatest blessings in life are inextricably bound up in the fellowship that God shares with us. Blessings from God are not rewards separate from that fellowship. You know, we would probably all experience much more joy in our Advent celebrations if we celebrated the truth that the glory of Christmas came about by the willingness of ordinary people to obey God's extraordinary claim on their lives. God's choosing them. God's choosing us. The joy that we are guilty of leaving behind is the joy that comes from opening our hearts to the presence of Christ. The joy that comes from letting God bless us. The joy that comes from entrusting ourselves to God's care. That's what Zechariah couldn't do, and what Mary did, after all. And that's what saved her from the sin of leaving the joy of the Lord behind her. That's what turned new news into good news for her ears and put words of praise in her mouth. So friends, in the middle of our stressful lives, know that God wants you and me to experience joy. God wants us to know that God favors us, that God treasures us, and that God will not fail us. God sends Jesus to remind us that He is with us always, at the very center of the pains and problems of our lives. So may we all accept this gift from God the way Mary did. Now, before we end this morning, I wonder if you'd like to hear the rest of the story about Stravinsky's unsuccessful first hearing of his orchestral ballet that night in Paris in 1913. Well, after that evening's melee, the ballet did continue running at the theater for many months. Jeremy Larson cites in his article that subsequent performances were packed, and at each one, the opposition dwindled. At a concert performance of Rite of Spring, 1 year later, the papers reported that unprecedented exaltation and a fever of adoration swept over the crowd, and admirers mobbed Stravinsky in the street afterward in a riot of delight. Did you know that was Zechariah's experience, too? Many months later. The great author and preacher Barbara Brown Taylor has suggested that Zechariah's silence was not a punishment, but a gift of time from God that Zechariah needed to believe. She writes, it was a wilderness in which the dream was born in his heart and spirit. And when it had been born, when Zechariah finally opened his heart to the joy that comes from letting God bless us, to the joy that comes from entrusting ourselves to God's care. Then Zechariah announced to the world, his name is John. And then he could speak and he began praising God, just like Mary. Yes, it may have taken Zechariah longer, as it no doubt has taken many down through the ages longer. But in his silent pondering and listening in his heart and mind over and over and over again to God's message of remembrance and love and promise of blessing to him and Elizabeth, the new news became the good news. And the angelic noise became music to his ears and put words of praise in his mouth. Friends, we would all do well to read both Mary's song and Zechariah's song, which are found in Luke chapter 1, in preparation for hearing the story of the birth of Jesus in Luke chapter 2 on Christmas Eve. Jeremy Larson ends his article about why we don't like to listen to new music with words that seem like they were written specifically for the gospel lesson from Luke on this fourth Sunday in Advent. He ends by saying this: the act of listening to new music is hard, but it is necessary. After all, what is unheard could define history. Better to come for the show. So my friends, whether you've heard the music of the good news of God's love for you once or 1,000 times, we want you to hear it again anew. So we want to give you an early Christmas present. Starting January 3rd, the Reverend Bob Ward from our congregation will be offering a 5-week Bible study of the Gospels, with an opening week kickoff overview of the entire sweep of the Bible. And then, a week or two later, Area United Methodist Church pastors, including moi, will be offering the popular Disciple One Bible study on Sunday evenings. Both of those studies are going to meet on Zoom, so please watch your walkie wire for more information. And of course, Dennis will be giving you some more updates here in the next week and so. But I'll tell you this. Knowing what I know about Reverend Ward and the other area pastors who are going to be leading the Bible studies, you will almost certainly hear something new about God's Word that you have not heard before. May that new news become good news to you. So again, as we end, think about this. The act of listening to new music is hard, but it is necessary. After all, what is unheard could define your history. Better to come for the show. Amen. Well, my friends, I want to thank you again, wherever you are, for joining us today in worship. May the Spirit of God lead you on the final steps of the Advent journey in a spirit of hope and peace and joy and love, and bring you at last to Bethlehem, to the stable, to the manger, and to the Christ child. As you go out today, may the Lord go with you. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace, now and forever. Amen.